And now our second speaker is going to make us look at another aspect of us with completely new eyes. And it actually stretches back 150 million years, which is a storage of energy, which has taken 150 million years to accumulate. We have finished in almost just 150 years. And when we are talking about that past and the future that lies ahead for us, Mansoor Khan, who began as a director, who's made films like Kayamat Se Kayamat Tak, Jo Jeeta Wohi Sikandar, launched his cousin Aamir Khan, made the very wise decision of moving away from Bollywood to actually start an organic cheese farm in Kunur. And he may be really the last man standing and laughing that he made that decision when the rest of us go down doing something else. The book that Mansoor Khan wrote is called The Third Curve. And what he's really looking at is the illusion of the money economy. It's interesting that spiritually, philosophically, you know, we are asked to look at wealth and money creation as really an illusion. But Mansoor actually proves why the very concept of money as it stands today, the whole money economy based on the energy economy, is an illusion, and there is an inevitability to the downward curve. He's talking about why global economies are going bust and boom with greater frequency, and what is the empirical truth of nature that we are not looking at. So at an age when climate change really is upon us, and barring Mr. Trump, everybody else accepts that it really is a reality that we are looking at, ladies and gentlemen, we couldn't have a more important speaker than Mansoor Khan today to share his ideas. Please welcome him on stage.
So Shoma made me sound like an economist. I absolutely resent that. yeah, but about economies and all that. So I have a very tricky past, you know, like I keep changing it every 8 years. So I was an engineer, then I became a filmmaker, then I'm supposed to be a farmer, and so on and so forth. But because of restriction of time, I'm going to start straight away, and you'll understand where I'm coming from. But it's not a moral subject. First of all, I want you to understand, I'm not speaking from a moral perspective. It's not about what is right, what is wrong. I'm a reality check guy. So I'm saying, is it possible? This is reality, is it possible? And I'm using whatever skills I have to explain this to you. So The Third Curve is my book, The End of Growth. Sorry, I don't have it here, but it's available free on the net. The end of growth, that's the key line, because growth, that word, is our religion. We believe, how many of you believe perpetual growth is possible? Okay, I think I'm winning. How many of you think it's a good thing? Hey, I'm winning here also. Okay, so let's go back. Okay, that was just a preamble. So we're talking about modern industrial times. From 1750, phase one started. We got all these wonderful things, cars, this, that. We thought modern times, you know, which Charlie Chaplin has made a movie about. Electronics, satellites, surplus food, computers, telecom, cars, medicine. It's like we've never had it better. Okay, mega cities, space travel. The sky was the limit. We thought nothing can stop us. These were called paradise times. So 1750, 1960. We enter into phase two from 1960, and suddenly everything switched around. We had species extinction, we had falling water tables, soil fertility loss, drying rivers, water crisis, you know, right, building up through all these different things which you already know about. But the key thing is that suddenly life was withering. So we said, wow, we're doing wonderful, we'll conquer the whole future. We'll never have to worry about food, we'll have no diseases, we'll live on the moon. But suddenly something else happened. We entered into the phase two, which is the ecological collapse. You're well aware of it. My talk is not about that either. What happened in phase three was even more surprising. From 2008, actually, it was already happening. It's not like it suddenly happened. But inflation is rising, failing banks, devalued currencies, financial instruments which are crazy, derivatives, hedge funds, inequity, more poor people, a few people have like most of the money, food prices going crazy, debt. What was happening? Financial and the boom, which happened in 2008, you all know about. But we didn't suffer it, so we really don't know about it. But it seems like money itself was withering. So great times, ecological collapse, money collapse. So my question is, what is the connection between all these great things that we feel we should be working for and all these things which are connected with life and all these things which are connected with money? Can anybody tell me? What is the connection between these three disparate things? Sorry? That's right. It's not greed. It's growth. Growth is our religion. We believe this we should do. My topic is basically around that, but I'll quickly go into it. Again, I already asked you this question. Is perpetual growth possible? Have you seen anything that grows forever on this planet? Then how come we think our industry can grow forever? How come we think that our economy can grow forever? How can we think our consumer goods can grow forever? Anyway, if you believe that it's possible, I'll come to that. Is it desirable? I'll come to that also. So let's go for the first question. So to explain, what do we mean by growth? Okay, I don't mean the growth, qualitative growth. Like I love my parents more, I love my family more, you guys love your family more. That's qualitative growth. We're not talking about that kind of growth. We're talking quantitative growth. 2 becomes 4, becomes 8, becomes 16, becomes 32. That's what we, when we use the word growth, GDP growth, industrial growth. Just keep that clear. So here's our mind, and here's a glass. Our mind says lift up the glass, but the mind is only creating the concept. The thing that has to lift the glass is the body. So on the left is the concept, on the right is reality. Left is mind, right is body. I color coded as red and green. Red is concept, green is body. So your mind, which is into growth, says, let's lift up something heavier. So you think of a chair, and once more your body can do it. Then you say, why not lift this up? So you go through various things until you can eventually say, why don't you lift up a truck? So nobody, even a kid, can tell you that that's not possible, which tells you that minds have limits. Minds have no limits, but bodies have limits, okay? Simple thing, you'll say that's too fundamental. Why are we even thinking about it? I wouldn't even be talking about it if he had not forgotten it. The ultimate concept of growth is money. Your whole system is based on the idea of X percent interest, X percent compound. Your whole GDP idea and everything is based on growth forever. Now, what are the laws of money and who's made it? So money, if you notice, there's a red ring around it. Every time you see red, think of mind, think of concept. Think of something that we have come up with, okay? We said this should be like this. So we said money is value. Here's bread, here's 10 rupees. Which one do you eat? The bread. But money is mapping the value of bread. It's not the value. It is only mapping the value. It is representing the value of bread. It's saying bread should be 10 rupees. But it never says that money is equal to value, which is what we started believing. And after some time, we feel that money cannot stay stagnant. If I lend you 10 lakhs, or rather, put it the other way around, if you lend me 10 lakhs, and I'll say I'll give you 10 lakhs back after 5 years, would you agree? No. If any of you agree, I'll take it right now. No, why make it 10 lakhs? How about 1,000 crores? So we immediately logically felt like money should have time value. It sounds logical. So there came the second concept. So each time you see a ring, it is another concept that we've come up with. And we came up with the idea that money cannot remain like this. It goes like this. But very soon we come up with a third idea. We say if you don't return the interest, then I should get interest on the interest. Wonderful. Then your money grows like this. Now who would prefer this? How many of you like this or this? So we were like, there's no choice here. This is great. Now this is so amazing. This curve, see, you see this curve reaches the right side of the paper. This curve mathematically doesn't even reach the right side of the paper. It goes to the vertical. It's going boom, 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 boom. I mean, it's amazing what you have created just with three little concepts. You have created a monster, okay? But it sounds so good that we say, let it go on forever. So the fourth concept we come up with is, this should happen forever. Perpetual exponential quantitative growth is how we have defined how money should work. We have defined. That I call the money onion, because it looks like an onion, doesn't it? Layers of concepts. You take out a, you know, you say peel an onion and you get one more ring. Peel it, you get another ring, peel it. This is the other way around. You're adding the rings, which means you can go on forever. This looks dangerous. Economics is built on this premise. 10 lakhs at 7%, it doubles in 10 years, 20 lakhs. In just 10 decades, which is 100 years, which is within my son's life, it becomes 100 crores. I don't need to work, he doesn't need to work. And maybe all the folks after that don't need to work. That's 1,024 times. It has gone up 1,024 times in 10 decades. And if you just do one more decade, it's 200 crores. Just in that one decade, it has achieved what it achieved in 10 decades. Now we say this is great. But what nobody tells you is that so does the consumption of our resources follow this pattern. You can say we want our money to go like this, but your resources have to go in the same pattern. And this is the kind of graphs you don't see in any management, economic, or anywhere, which is money, the red curve, from 1850 has gone as you wanted it to, but so has the energy consumption. So it is following the same pattern. If energy doesn't go that way, your money cannot go that way. If you don't eat food, you can't run faster. And it's not only energy, it's all resources. But the main one that runs any part of the world, whether it be your body or an ecological system or a forest or a river or a cloud or a wind system, is energy. Energy is the fundamental thing that runs any system. It's not money. Or otherwise, we'd offer you 1,000 rupee notes this evening, you know. You don't need 1,000 rupee notes. You have to give you food. So oil is the fundamental thing, form of energy. And 1750, that's exactly what happened, and we got growth. It was not oil, it was its cousin called coal. And coal, natural gas, oil, were these bounties of energy. It's like getting a machine gun in your hand. When you have a machine gun in your hand, as opposed to a, what's it called? A catty. With a catty, you can only do this much. With a machine gun, you can take over. So that's what energy means. That's the difference between economics, red, mind, concept, and energetics, energy, reality, body. Money is a concept. It comes from the mind, our mind. We decide. And the whole discipline around it is called economics, which is revered as the ultimate discipline. Energy is reality. That comes from the body. Now, whether it be our body or the body of the earth or the body of the universe, it comes from there. And that discipline is called energetics. I've written a chapter on this. There's a new book coming out in which there are 14 people who have written, but I won't go into that. What I mean is that this is going to be the new emerging word that you will be beginning to hear, energetics, rather than economics. Economic rules, we make. Energetic rules, God makes. Now, I leave it to you to decide who's going to win. If you think that we can win, then we should continue doing what we're doing. Energetics, first of all, is about the available energy. And the available energy for us is defined by the earth. So much earth, so much fossil fuels, that's what you have. It's finite. All resources, in fact. So my argument is not only energy, because energy is the key resource. But with energy, you need iron ore, this thing, that thing, water, wood, you need other things to build your world. So energy is just one of them. But all resources follow this curve, which is when it's available to you, get it slow, faster, and it slows down. How many of you knew this? Nobody. Then what's the point of getting educated? Nowhere in the global education system do they tell you this. And I'm not making it up. This is geology. This is science. There's data. I can give you any amount of data on this. Okay? So we think we'll make an infinite model, whereas resources are finite. So quantity goes up, slow, up. And when only half is over, you reach your peak, just like our life. When you're 35, or whatever your middle age might be, you are the strongest, fastest, and after that you go slow. The Earth behaves exactly like that. That's why it's called the normal distribution function, because it's normal. It is the bell curve of resources. But we don't teach this anyway. The gentleman who just spoke before me, Manu, I really liked his talk. So a lot of stuff that we decide to tell people is what we want them to hear. Even though we know that this is the truth, we will not talk about it. We'll shape it so that you hear it the way that the leaders, the kings, the powerful people, and the deluded people want you to hear it. Okay, my talk is not political, by the way. It is actually kind of a funny conditioning of our minds. First half, second half. After the second half, you go into descent. Anybody who's 60 years old like me, if I think I can frolic around like when I was 18, should have his head examined. So while we can do funny things like color our hair and wear a flowery t-shirt and say, yo, that doesn't mean that you have become 18. So this kind of the delusion we live in, but the Earth is not in that delusion. These are the laws of geology. So this was discovered by Hubbard. Now here I'll go a little faster because it's not a history lesson. But just to let you know that this is fact. There is science, there is data, there is history behind it. He realized America was the seat of oil in the 19th century. So 1850 onwards, America was the seat of oil, which is America is what it is, a superpower. Energy makes you a superpower. If you don't have energy, you cannot do it. You cannot do it. Now, whether being a superpower is a good thing or not is a different topic. But what I mean is that in America, you had oil. You remember Richie Rich, the cartoon character? What was his father? He was an oil millionaire, bichara yaar. Wo millionaire tha. Nowadays, millions means nothing. You've got to at least be a trillionaire, you know. So he noticed that each oil well behaved like this. Shell oil was prospecting, ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. He noticed a certain pattern. And he noticed that each oil well, whether it be small or big or medium, it adds up. It peaks. And when you add them all together, you get another peak. That means all the oil wells in a particular region, when you look at the region also behaves like this. You cannot cheat and make the region behave like this. The region will also behave like this. So the shape doesn't change. And this is the way he discovered it, was that the production peaked 40 years after your discovery peaked. So in a particular area, when you had finished finding the maximum oil and you were going down, 40 years later you'd hit the production. So this was true about Texas, it was true about Austin, it was true about, you know, any county or any state. And therefore he predicted that therefore it should be true for all of America. And he predicted, why is it not going back? Oh, sorry, this is the back one. So he predicted in 54, that America would reach its peak, that means the maximum oil it can get in 1970. And he was right, all the data is there. So he knew what he was talking about. And similarly, he predicted that the world will reach its peak, because global discoveries peaked in 60, that global production will peak in 2000. He said 2000, he was wrong by 5 years. But there's a reason for that, that's because there's a dip in the graph when OPEC was formed. Okay, so let's go quickly, we have a lot more to do. But why are we talking about oil? Everybody say, oh, we have solar, we have wind, we have this, we have that. For that, you have to sit with me comfortably for a whole evening. The physics guys are telling you total lies. There's a huge difference between your salary and your father's and forefather's saving account for the last 500 million years. You're comparing your salary, solar, to the same solar which has collected for 500 million years. which is oil, which half-witted physics guy has fooled all the economists into believing that that is the truth. It is not. So solar can never do. If anybody is telling you, no, only Mansoor solar will do it, chapter 3 of my book demolishes it. It is just not possible for your salary to match your forefather's, you know, $500 trillion savings account and do the same thing. So it is the blood of the industrial world. But it's not only the quantity. It runs the world. It builds the world. Look around you. You've got 6,000 byproducts of petroleum in which you are right now embedded. Please replace that. Tell me, how will you get plastics from solar panels? How will you get lubricants from windmills? How will you get bitumen for your roads from nuclear plants? So it's an illusion that we can just switch from this to that. So it builds your world. You're embedded in it. And it's irreplaceable in nature. So what happens when oil peaks? What happens to your whole world, your whole life? So here it is. We say money, which is from the mind of the financial system, and oil, which is from the body, and that's the real thing. When you put them together, and this is real data now. This is not a conceptual curve. This is real data. Your money has grown just exactly as we wanted it to. But oil has gone like this, and now is beginning to go down, as predicted by Hubbard. When you put them together, they don't match. Does it look like you can do the same thing from that point? I think this has got a pointer here. Yeah. From here, where they start separating, is this the same? While they were going together, everything was fine. It's like this is your son's expectation, and this is your salary. While your son's expectation is going like this, and your salary is going like this, everything is fine. But after that point, when your son's expectation goes like this and your salary goes like this, everything is not fine. And in the third part, when your son's expectations continue to go that way and your salary is now going this way, then everything is even more than not fine. And that's where we are. So quickly, phase one, phase two, phase three. I mentioned them to you. I'll go very quickly through this because I think I've taken more time. Phase one, everything is fine. Money growth is proportionate. Your actual growth, your real production, is proportionate to the amount of energy available. So everything is fine. Your money is really worth what it is. But after this point, and by the way, we did this with this money onion, with those four laws, okay? But after that point, after point one, when there is a differential between what the earth can give you and what you want, between your salary and your son's expectation, that differential, how do you fill it? It's not real. You can't actually make more if you have only 1,000 eggs. Or if you have 10,000 eggs or whatever that is, you can't do anything beyond that. So we come up with another concept. If you've noticed, another ring has been added called the stock market. So what we do is we add another concept. Every time you're in trouble, money is not growing, add another concept. Stock market means a gambling den. It's a casino. So if I take a glass of milk and I pass it around and say, how much will you give me for this? 10 rupees? 20? 40? 80? 60? Da-da-da-da-da. 1 lakh. But that glass of milk still feeds only one baby. What have I increased? We have increased a perceptual betting value to it. And we believe in it. We honestly believe our shares have gone from 100 rupees a share to 10,000 rupees a share. It's a conceptual, notional increase. That's why gambling dens are banned anywhere in the world. Gambling is a sin in any religion. In Goa, you have to go in the middle of the river to gamble.
So why are you calling it growth? Isn't it greed?
No, it's not greed. It's an illusion. See, I'll come to that, sir. So we don't call it greed. If a panwala puts 10 lakhs in the bank because he's been told to, he's not greedy. He's been told this is a system. How can you call a panwala greedy? You've conditioned him to believe that you cannot keep money under your bed. It will depreciate. So usko bhi bechare ko bola gaya, bhaiya, ye to system hai. It's not greed, sir. You know, we tend to go that way. That's our first reaction. But yes, greed will come out of it. I agree with you. But it's not. That's not the cause. That's the effect. So as we were in problem and you had to keep increasing the differential which is going, because that differential, you've made an impossible model. And you can't follow that impossible model, so you do it conceptually. In real terms, you can't make more. Tata cannot make more trucks, but Tata can just sell its shares. So the idea of creating newer and newer concepts, from stock markets to fractional reserve banking to no gold standard, which means now your money is fiat. It has got nothing to do with gold standard. Earlier, you had so much gold, you printed so much money. In 71, Nixon said, sorry, guys, because you've reached the ceiling. You have only so much gold. How much money can you print? I mean, this is something that any kid of 9 years old would have already told you. How can you have an infinite model based on growth in standard when you only have so much gold? A kid that has not gone to normal school would have told you that, but a kid that's gone to normal school cannot tell you that, because he's been conditioned into that belief that, yes, we'll find a way. And we were doing and finding a way in a conceptual way. So we kept creating. But do you notice one thing? With this concept, we were getting growth. But there was another thing that was invisibly starting here called risk. Because that was imaginary growth. It was not real. Tata has not made more trucks, but Tata's share price is there. So what are you building into the system? Risk. Today you have risk management agencies, and I went and asked them. I said, why is there so much risk in the system? They had no answer. I've spoken at CRISIL. I said, why is there? Because we've designed the risk. We've made the risk come into the system because we are doing imaginary things. Reality is finite. We are making an infinite model. Your life is finite. You're saying, no, I'm going to live forever. So leveraging was the next concept. Sorry, I must say this a little bit. In physics, see, we keep borrowing things from real things. The term lever, you know what a lever is, right? You put a lever like this and you can pick up something heavy. You can lift up a 10 kg with just 1 kg. So we borrowed that from the real world, that concept, and plugged it into our conceptual world that you can pick up a lot of money just with a little bit of money. And that's how we added the next concept. So somebody who wants to borrow 5,000 crores but has only 50 crores can now put 50 crores down and the bank will give him 5,000 crores. That's called leveraging. Now, if I put 50 crores down and if I pick up 5,000 crores and I'm not able to pay it back, isn't there a risk involved? Now, what does the bank do? Bank says, oh shit, yeah, if Mansoor doesn't return it, what do we do? So bank invents another, not bank, but the economic system says options. Let's design a concept called options. He can take an option on it. If he doesn't pay back, he pays a small amount to default. My question to you, I've picked up 5,000 crores from the bank and I've put down only 50 crores. And we are sitting, the bank and I are sitting to decide what should that premium be or what should that escape amount be in case I'm not able to pay back. Well, it's happening. But you don't get a Nobel Prize for it. That's the problem. So 50 crores, 5,000 crores. What is the answer? What should be the premium amount? It's a very simple answer, guys. Can anyone tell me? 50 crores is what I've put down, 5,000 crores is what I've borrowed. That's the answer. And I'm not joking. These guys who came up with this equation, it's called the Black and Scholes derivative options pricing formula. They got the Nobel Prize for it. Bhaiya, main bhi karta hun ye kal yaar. Why should I make QSQT and all that? I should do this. And the wonderful part is that when they did this and they got the Nobel Prize, they used that same formula to start a company called Long-Term Capital Management, LTCM, made a lot of money and then lost $4.6 billion. They got bust. The whole American economy was going to come down and they bailed them out. The American, which is a capitalistic state, supposing you goof up in your private business, is Mr. Arun Jaitley going to come and bail you out? And they're talking about a capital, not even a socialist state, not even an Islamic fundamentalist state, not even a this thing. They said, no, guys, we can't. The whole system will come crashing. Boom. Chalo, I don't mind here. They bailed them out here. But they didn't even take the Nobel Prize back. That's what really hurts. So this is the way we keep creating concepts. We are a conceptual. We live in maps. Money is a map. Bread is real. I can create any rule for a map. I cannot create a rule for the real stuff. So we believe in words. Sorry, that's my next book. I shouldn't go there. But that's what it is. In a way, it is connected to that. Boom, boom, boom. Repeal Glass-Steagall Act. 2008, before that, we knew, people like us who were studying this, knew that the global economy is going to go bust. And not only did we know that the global economy is going to be bust, but this was the peak of the global economy ever. Because now we're entering into the phase three, which is what we are. 2008, 2018, 10 years. India's got 9 lakh crores worth of non-performing assets. The fourth fastest growing economy in the world has got 9 lakh crores, and nobody even knows what the real number is. Because you're making gas. You're just making gas. It's not India's fault. This is a global concept. It's not India. India is now following those rules. We are following the stupid rules that, you know, everybody else was following. This is called the growth trap. Boom. So you can see, this is what you want. This is what's possible. So when it goes like this, fine. When it separates, and see the difference of the separation. It's exponentially increasing. America's debt, when Bush was there, was $4 trillion. After just, it's $21 trillion. Japan is in negative interest rates. Europe is bust. These are not because of administrative problems or political decisions or some freaky thing that poor Mr. Jaitley did or Mr. Modi did. It's got nothing. We tend to blame our leaders. It is baked in the cake. The cake is baked that way. This is called the growth trap. You get unbelievable growth by concepts. But you get crazy risk because it's not real. The first graph, US GDP, real products, 14 trillion. Second graph, world GDP, 50 trillion. Real stuff. GDP means aapne kitna banaya. Gross domestic product. The global industrial production for the last 100 years is 100 trillion. And just in 2007, your derivatives in 1 year is 1,000 trillion. How is it possible? That in 1 year, just your derivatives, which are imaginary instruments, which actually brought down the global economy, is worth 10 times more than the whole economic system has produced over the last 100 years? Which school is teaching you this? They're just telling you, this guy failed, that guy failed, let's bring Trump back, let's take Jaitley back, Modi was a good guy. We're talking nonsense. We're fundamentally out of touch with reality. And people like us who are waiting for that to happen, this guy is a financial banker. Thoda pareshan dikh raha hai. That is only after. 2008, there was an explosion, which we were waiting. You know, like you know something is going to explode. You've lit something and you run out of the kitchen because you know your gas cylinder is going to explode. People like us were like that. And everybody else was, buy, buy, buy. This is great. It's a boom. It's a boom. It's a boom. It's a boom. And there was a boom. You know, the whole economy tanked. $50 trillion worth of this, what you said is, what your wealth is, which is imaginary, disappeared over 6 months. But it had to. Three phases of growth, and it is but obvious. Two, concept, reality. It has to go through phase one, where it will be true. It has to go through phase two, where it will be false. But phase three, it fails. We are in phase three. Are you going to contest geology? Are you going to contest the laws of thermodynamics? Just by changing your policies, increasing liquidity, dropping interest rates? Is that how your body becomes stronger? You say, kaam karte hai yaar. Thoda Shakespeare padh lete hai. What has Shakespeare got to do with your muscles? So we are living in this kind of a funny world. 1750 created this. Oh, the bell is gone. We are in shrinkage now. But I'll quickly come to the second question. Is it desirable? If this was a patient in ICU, your friend of yours, and his each one of these things is his heartbeat, body temperature, cholesterol level. They're all going crazy. What would you say is happening to this patient? He's dying. But these graphs are not of a patient. These graphs are of your earth, which is the largest organism that we ever know, that we know of. We are part of that organism. It's called Gaia. Species extinction, crazy. Loss of tropical rainforest, going crazy. Is it supposed to be like that? It has been traditionally flat, but just now it's going up like this. Each one of your fisheries exploited, water usage, CO2, which we call the environmental collapse, and we believe there are some stupid people are going out in the middle of the night and hacking trees. I have not seen anybody going in the middle of the night and hacking trees. It's happening because your system is doing it. It's not some people who are doing it, we all are doing it to run our system. So this is the crazy thing, that the cause of it, because there's one more red line there, can you guess what that cause is? That is making all these things go crazy. Your groundwater is gone, your species have gone, your pollution. What is that cause? The GDP of the world. And we all say, oh, GDP must go up. That is your fundamental belief. This is our religion. Growth is the biggest religion in the world. It's not Islam, it's not Christianity, it's not Hinduism, it's not whichever one. All of them collectively combined and multiplied into 1,000 is the religion of growth. Blindly you say, growth must go on forever. Whether it's possible and whether it kills. That's how deluded we are. The disease, growth for the sake of growth, is the ideology of a cancer cell. Think about it for 3.5 minutes. If one cell in your body, all cells are supposed to live and die, live and die. A cell has a finite life. This cell has its time. It says, oh, okay, I'm going, guys. Another one comes. And that's why you more or less remain the same. But if one cell says, I'm not going to die, it becomes two. It says, I'm not going to die, I'm into growth. 4, 8, 16, 32. That's this curve. It's called an exponential curve. All maths guys should be taught this, okay? I'm sorry, everybody should be taught this mathematically. And what does the cancer cell do? It first kills your organ, the liver or wherever it was, and then it looks for an emerging market. When it finishes with the liver, it says, hey guys, let's look for an emerging market, which is what India and China are. India and China are the last two organs to be eaten on this planet. And when I walked down and I saw all those wonderful business meetings, and I've got my money in my bank too, we're all saying, come guys, eat us up. Eat up our rivers. Why is Beijing polluted? No, it's polluted because we don't have norms. What norms can you have? Why is Delhi so polluted? Oh, because we don't have norms. We are deluded. There is no other way. And those guys are doing it at the cost of the third world. Conclusion, it's not possible. It is a disease, it's global cancer. What you're seeing, the environmental collapse, is the side effect of our belief called growth. It is not something that can be treated separately. My book is called this because this is the amount of energy we used to get from the sun. That was our budget. We were supposed to live in that budget. This is the budget. Your body has a budget. Each one of you has a separate budget. If I'm older, my body works within this. If somebody's younger, fatter, stronger, elephant's budget is here. Every system has a third curve. It is called the limits of energy in which it should operate. When we found, in 1750, we found 500 million years of savings account. We went boom, 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 burning it up to the sky, imagining that we are the gods. But it reached a peak, and we are up there right now, right at the top over here. And this people, like anybody who's been studying the data, geology, laws of physics, all that stuff, already knew it. It was no surprise to us. 10 years after that, we still don't know. And what are we? We are in denial. We are saying we're going to get the right government to do it. We're going to get the right policies. RBI has to give the right liquidity. We have to just not. Bichara abhi wo governor gaya na, the second governor to go, because you can't do it. CO heads are chopping, you know, CEOs are jumping off from the bandwagon. We are in denial. We are saying, nahin, hum toh upar le hi jayenge. Aap kaise le jayenge? When you do it through denial, you extend the moment, like Viagra. You think, oh shit, man, I mean, I can take Viagra and I can be... But actually, you're... Or forget Viagra, matlab, that's too personal. But what about steroids, which is being more openly admitted and investigated? When a runner refuses to accept that, bhaiya, I have reached the peak of my body, the biological limits of my body, why are so many runners being caught for it? Because we still believe in growth. His body extends for a while, it collapses. Extends for a while, collapses. That's called the staircase collapse model of civilization. All civilizations all over the world have. Okay, so I come to the end. Or you can come through acceptance. You recognize there are limits. You recognize the world runs on energy. You recognize it's a bell curve. That's called transition. Now, sorry, Shoma, you had told me to talk about transition, but I've used up all my time. But end of growth, because transition is when all of you all will say, Mansoor, then what do we do? So transition explains that. Chapter 5 of my book, and my book is free, by the way, guys. I couldn't bring it here. Just search for it, say Mansoor cheese, because we have a cheese farm. In Google, if you say Mansoor cheese, this thing will come up. Please download it, and everything is explained there. So we have to either deal with reality, or reality will deal with us. Reality does not negotiate. Okay? That's it. Thank you.